Hello everyone, this is Jaron from MarineAndReef.com, and today you're joining us as we build a new saltwater mixing station in our warehouse for our office tanks. Now, if you don't know what a saltwater mixing station is, I think a saltwater mixing station is oftentimes the secret to a long-term successful tank in your house, and that's because what a mixing station is it's a place for you to easily mix saltwater and to store some purified RO water. And what this lets you do is much more easily top off your tank or top off your auto top off reservoir, as well as do water changes. Very often, the easier something is to do, the more you're gonna do it. So by simply having an easy source of salt water on hand, a lot of times you actually wind up doing your maintenance more regularly, which leads to real benefits for the tank. I think this is something that pretty much no one would regret who's in this hobby for a long time, because you're going to need salt water. Having it on hand is fantastic. It's also fantastic in an emergency. If something bad happened to your tank and you needed to do an immediate 30-gallon water change, do you have 30 gallons of water on hand, or would you have to wait a few hours to get that ready? The fact that the salt water is going to be ready to go, it's going to allow us to respond more readily to those emergencies. Let's show you guys what we've picked out for our mixing station, why we've picked it out, and then we're going to plumb everything up, connect it all together, and show you guys how it works. So first off, whenever you're planning a mixing station, the first thing I would suggest is you pick a location for your mixing station. Now here, this is a back corner of our warehouse where we've kept our RO system here with this wash sink. And so far we've been mixing water in these little 5-gallon jugs, but it's just gotten impractical. Sometimes there's 4 of them crammed in here. Nobody can use the sink for what it's actually supposed to be used for. And we're blowing through these 5-gallon water jugs way too fast. So right next to this is where we decided to put our mixing station. Most people will put a mixing station, say, in a garage or a closet or a spare room. I've even seen some outdoors. That is totally fine. It's typically something in the center of your living room. My personal mixing station at home is in my garage. I just mix my salt water there, and then I have a pump to pump it inside, or I can put it in 5-gallon buckets to take inside. Once you've selected your location, the next thing you want to pick is your containers. Now, when it comes to picking containers, there's a lot of options, but one of the most popular are trash cans, and that's what we've done today. These are U-line trash cans. The Brute brand of trash can is also very popular. I pick these because I like the fact that you can get them in different colors, so we can have a blue saltwater one and a white RO water one to kind of differentiate them. And I also like that I was able to get them in the 55-gallon size. And that's nice because most salt mix is going to come in 50-gallon bags. So if this trash can isn't quite filled all the way, we can have it so one trash can equals one bag of salt, and that'll make for very easy mixing, very consistent mixing. I'm going to show you guys how we figure that out once we get things going. But it's going to be very nice to know that when I fill this up, I just add one bag of salt and it's done. I don't have to measure it out more than that because you've already done the measurements ahead of time. In addition to your trash cans, or your saltwater reservoir, another thing to consider is you may want a platform. Now, this is a platform I built myself. It's very crude, just out of 2x4s and spare lumber, and it cost me just about $100 in parts, so it really wasn't that expensive. But the nice thing about this platform is it's gonna let us store things underneath it, like our buckets or our salt mix, and that's gonna be convenient for storage sake. But the other thing is, once we get this all done, we'll be able to put our bucket below and have it gravity drain into the bucket. So you don't have to do that. You could have a mixing station with your containers on the ground, but if they're on the ground, then you can't put a spigot to drain into your bucket. And it is very nice to have a spigot that drains in. So you may want some kind of platform. I'm not gonna give you guys a woodworking class, but just know that even me, who is not a woodworker, is able to make a simple 2x4 platform for my water mixing containers. The next step, once you got your mixing containers in place, you kind of got a platform if you want one, you got your spot picked out, is you're gonna want some kind of pump to mix the salt water for you. Now, when it comes to selecting your pump, really for a mixing station, I don't really care if the pump is loud. It's often in a garage or in the warehouse where it doesn't really matter. It's not in a living area. I don't care much if it's very energy efficient, because it's only gonna run for a couple hours, maybe every other week or so, to get the salt mixed up. But what I am concerned about is that this pump that's gonna be mixing your salt water is gonna be sucking in rough salt crystals. It's in a very high precipitation environment, often the calcium and elements in the salt can cake up on this pump. So I really like something that's super durable. And because of that, I've selected this Iwaki Model 30. The Iwaki pumps are just legendarily durable. So I think this should last a very long time and hold up well in this harsh environment. Even though it's maybe not the quietest or the most energy efficient pump, it is super duper long lasting and heavy duty. And that's what we're wanting here. The other parts we selected for this is I have selected two Hydros water level sensors. These are going to connect to the hydro system that we have here on our RO. You don't necessarily need to do this, but one thing I really, really like is either using the Hydros, or you can use a system like that from SpectraPure or Tunzi to automatically top off your water bin. So without getting into too much of the details, when your RO system first turns on, it's very inefficient. And for this reason, you want to avoid using a simple float valve in your freshwater container, because every time you take any bit of water out, it's going to turn the RO system on and it'll run for just a couple minutes, but it'll be at its most inefficient point. And that means you burn through a whole lot of DI resin, and it's going to cost you a lot more than if you made a lot of water at once. So one option is to just wait till the water level is low and then manually turn on your RO system to fill it back up. But we're going to automate that process. So with these water level sensors and our Hydros controller, once we put the sensors in place, we're going to have a low sensor and a high sensor. It'll turn the RO system on when it hits the low level, and then it will make water till it hits the top sensor. And that'll make sure it's at least, say, 30 gallons of water each go, and that'll prevent the constant what's called TDS creep, or poor performance, when the RO system only turns on for a minute or two. It'll run for a long period of time. This is actually the one thing that I believe has made the biggest difference into how long my DI resin at home lasts, is trying to make at least 30 to 40 gallons of water at once. It makes it much, much more efficient than making 5 gallon batches, because you're getting more time at the RO working at its peak, since it doesn't perform well at the start. So we're going to add that in. We've also going to add in some plumbing. And basically what this plumbing's gonna do, we kinda got it all laid out here, we'll show you guys once you got it connected, is our pump that's gonna mix the salt water is also gonna be able to draw water from the freshwater bin, pump it into the saltwater bin so that we can mix it up, and then through a series of valves, we can then turn the pump on and mix the salt water in this container, as well as have tubes to drain both freshwater and salt water into buckets that we can use to fill the auto top off containers, or top off manually here in the office, or we can use to do our water changes. So having that spigot is basically making it an easy way to get the water out of these bins that we're gonna make the water in. So without further ado, we're gonna show you guys how we connect everything together and what it winds up looking like in the end. All right, everyone, we've now got our mixing station plumbed up and assembled, and we thought we'd just review exactly how it works, give you guys an idea if you want to do a project like this yourself. So on the left, we got our fresh water container. It's in this bucket here, and we'll go ahead and take the lid off so you guys can see what's going on. So you can see that inside this container, our RO system is now hard at work making some water, and we do have a float valve up at the top. Now, in theory, if you guys remember, once this sensor at the top is triggered, it'll turn off the RO system. So you guys may be asking why you have the float valve. And that's really just in case, because we really don't want this flooding our warehouse over the weekend when nobody's here and coming back to water pouring over everything. So the fact that we have that float valve means even if the electronics fail, it's still going to shut itself off. The electronics are less to stop an overflow and more to make sure the system is working efficiently, that is turning on at the bottom and off at the top. Without further ado, I thought I'd see if we could show you guys what happens. So we're going to grab this top sensor, and I'm just going to get it wet. All right, and the system just turned off. And you notice now that it's dry, it's still not turning back on. And that's because the way this works, it won't turn on until the bottom sensor is dry, and then it will fill to the top. And that's what ensures that we were making at least a good, given where I've placed them, at least a good 35 gallons of water at a time, which will make sure our RO system works a lot more efficiently than if it was just clicking on and off with a simple float valve alone. The water comes out of this freshwater bin into this tube here, and we have a valve. Now, right now, this valve is open, and it'll be open most of the time. So with this valve open, you could then use the hose down below to fill a bucket or a jug and then take it to top off a tank. And we also have a pathway to our pump here. So this Milwaukee pump is going to allow us to transfer water from our freshwater container to our saltwater container. And let's go ahead and do that. We're just going to click it on. We're going to turn it off so you guys can hear me a little bit. But very simple. All we have to do is click that switch on in order to transfer the water to this saltwater mixing bin. And then if we want to stop transferring the water and then work on mixing the water in this bin, what we would do is we would close this valve. This way water is no longer passing from the freshwater container. Then we're going to open this one. That way water is going to come from the saltwater container and into our pump. And then by turning the pump on, it'll recirculate and mix itself. And then we don't quite have enough water in there to show you guys that, but we would simply click it on to mix. And this is going to be very nice and convenient. Once there's salt water mixed in this bin, we got a little hose here, and this will let us dispense that into our bucket or our jug to do our regular water changes. Now, I thought I'd go over some of our choices with some of the items. We already talked about the pump, the Milwaukee pump. We choose this because it's extra durable when it comes to sucking in salt crystals. I've gone ahead and opted to do all flexible tubing. If you guys go on the internet, it's really popular and super cool looking to go with hard plumbing. But in my experience, the soft plumbing is going to allow us to more easily move these around. If we need to take one of the trash cans out and clean it or service it in some way, it's just going to be a lot more convenient that it's all soft plumbed. And I don't find the soft plumbing any less or more likely to leak. I find it pretty much the same as hard plumbing, so you might as well go that route. Before our pump, we have this true union valve. This is because if we want to, we can go ahead and close it off and then remove the pump without all of the water gushing out when we remove the pump. So we're cutting off the water here. This is then removable. You'll get a little bit of water that comes out, what's left in this tube and this little bit here, but you don't have to wait till the containers are totally dry in order to service that pump when it comes time to do that. For these valves here, I went with these two little fishies valves. I really, really like these. And the reason why is oftentimes your basic hardware store valve works for like a week and then it becomes basically impossible to move. These two little fishies valves are much easier to move. They tend to work for a very long time. They're very reliable, but they're also pretty affordable. So this union ball valve, we did use one of these. These valves can easily be $50 or more. I've seen some $70, $80 union ball valves. These two little fishies valves are far, far better priced. The price will vary based on size, but instead of a maximum $75 valve, you may be looking at a maximum $12 valve. And it's going to be a very affordable valve that's still going to be easy to open and close. Well, that's pretty much all there is to it. If you guys like this video and are interested in more reef aquarium or saltwater aquarium related projects, then like and subscribe. We'll have more videos like this to come.